Hey everyone, this is Kim O'Neill from the Every Day is a New Day podcast and live show, and you're listening to the Going North podcast with the hilarious Dom Brightman. Be sure to subscribe to his show so you don't miss any episodes, and remember, every day is always a new day.
And today on the Going North podcast, where we like to call it GMP, the Great Glorious Saying Llamas, where it helps authors take these wonderful bricks of media appearances and build a highlight reel, we got one heck of a super special awesome human for you today, courtesy of my good buddy Cat with all the meows, Cat Canvas, and the super special awesome, my fellow September baby, Reverend Ariel Patricia from Sacred Stories Media / Publishing, because today's author in particular, another M2M invasion, y'all. That's right. Milk to milk. That's right. Wait, no, it's not milk to milk. It's Mayhem to Miracles, because my goodness, today's author in particular, from this book, she's a lawyer and recovered alcoholic who shares a passion for writing creative children's stories, a love for teaching, family, travel, adventure, and all of the world's amazing creatures, and most certainly llamas. And on top of that, she's a mom of four, an artist, writer, and poet. So let's give it up for Miss SC herself. And no, it's not South Kakalaki. It's the one and only Sharla Charpentier. How you doing today, Sharla?
Great. Thank you, Dom.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Yeah, struggling with her forward recording. Like, yeah, welcome to the danger zone. That's right. That's right. A stranger danger. That's right. Where you meet a stranger that may become a friend after recording, but it's over.
I love it. I need a new friend.
That's right. That's right. I could probably put on a penguin suit. You could put on a llama hat. It'll be great.
Yeah, perfect. I want to see that.
I guess I'd be the chocolate penguin in this case.
I'll be the vanilla llama.
Oh, you got more spice than that. We'll call you the French vanilla llama.
All right. Thank you.
But hey, it ain't about milk, chocolate, and French vanilla, even though those are great. So mind filling in any cavities I may have missed about you, because I'm sure I forgot a whole bunch of stuff since intros aren't allowed to be 53 days long.
Yes. You want me to say more intro for myself? I mean, you pretty much covered it. Mom of four, author, lawyer, author of the Love, Llama, and Friend series, co-authored with my cousin, Monica Talbot Kirkus. We've got two of the series books published. The Love Llama Travels the Seven Continents. Ned the Narwhal Voyages the Five Oceans. We're trying to teach kids while entertain them, especially about world awareness, geography, things that aren't really being taught in schools right now. And the Mayhem to Miracles book, where I tell my personal story of recovery and how I found all the miracles in my life that were already pretty much there, but I had the wrong perspective.
The wrong perspective. So what was the wrong perspective?
The wrong perspective was full of self-pity, not enough gratitude, unhealthy coping mechanisms, codependency. I put everyone above myself in kind of a victim martyr mentality. Didn't look out for, you know, my own wants and needs, and kind of continued that pattern for a long, long time.
Probably longer than two wiener dogs, I imagine.
Yes, definitely.
Yes, indeed. That's right. The mindset of a martyr. My goodness, because never heard those two words together. And that's probably one of the biggest things that can hold people back from having their own version of success in life. Because on one hand, it's a martyr from the religious perspective. Hey, they may think of the wonderful Jesus. On the other hand, it's like, hey, that person died for sins. And on with us, where our daily lives, like, hey, do you really have to see ourselves as a martyr just to help somebody get an extra cucumber? Like, hey, like, do we really have to help them to really do above and beyond stuff and, like, make ourselves completely broke in the process? Like, hey, ain't nothing wrong with self-sacrifice, but hey, also, like, keep self-care and self-preservation in mind too.
Absolutely. Yep, I didn't have those two things for a while.
Yeah. That's right, because you were trying to be a good girl with all the O's out of a Cheerios box, I hear.
That's right. I was trying to be the good daughter, the good then sister, the good student, the good employee, then the good wife, good mom, you know, just on and on. Doing the right thing, in quotes, right thing.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Yeah, because this is kind of one of the biggest traps ever. If it ain't imposter syndrome, it's trying to be the good person for all the good stuff. It's like, hey, nothing wrong with being a good human, a good person. But hey, also, like, hey, like, define what good truly means to yourself. It's like, hey, helping other people, it's great. But hey, don't make yourself a freaking doormat.
Right. I was not good to myself. I was a good person, but I wasn't being good to myself.
That's what I'm talking about, indeed. So how are you good to yourself now?
Oh, I have a lot of self-reflection, prayer, meditation. I try to hone in on what my wants and needs are and then be direct about asking for those to be met. Self-care in terms, even simple things like getting enough sleep and eating. I mean, even those things are hard for a mom. I think I barely have time for those things sometimes. Going to 12-step recovery meetings consistently. I have a therapist that I speak to consistently. You know, all those things that really make yourself, make your genuine self shine.
There you go. That's right. Your genuine self, indeed. That's right. She went from pleather to actual genuine leather. That's what I'm talking about. Hey.
Unless you're vegan, then I wouldn't say genuine.
I didn't butcher your name, but the vegans are still mad. Darn. Oh, well. They'll be fine. Oh, my goodness. Well, with all of this wonderful stuff that you're doing, one of my favorite lines that underlined in the book, heck, even the first start of the chapter, is the fact that your miracle started happening when you put yourself in your well being first. So my goodness, so the miracle of finally being your genuine self, being able to be at the place now where you're writing these wonderful children's books, my goodness, so what helped you to probably do that in addition to the wonderful 12 steps and finally focusing on, heck, even just actually taking care of yourself first before taking care of the world?
I connected with my cousin, reconnected with her, and we have followed this similar path in life. It's pretty amazing. She's also recovering alcoholic, has bipolar as well as I do. And we kind of both were at the stage where thinking, we're not getting any younger, you know, what do we actually want to do in life on this borrowed time? And we're both writers and we both love travel. We love animals. We love children. And so it just made sense that we put all that together to do this children's book series. And, you know, through perseverance and determination, we've been able to succeed so far. And the pandemic, believe it or not, actually helped us there were some advantages, not great in terms of not being able to go into schools and read to classrooms, which is, you know, my favorite thing to do, read the stories to the children. But in terms of our work life halted, and so it turned into this is we have time to do this, we have time to write these books, let's make this happen.
Well, congratulations indeed. Yep, because that's the thing about the pandemic, it's helped folks bring in the new boomer age. We had the baby boomers in the 1900s, but now we got the book boomers now. That's right. Got to...
Yeah, it is like that. I'm a book boomer.
That's right, a book boomer indeed. So my goodness, so I believe you have the narwhal, if I'm not mistaken, and the llamas. So why the llamas? Because that was more curious to me than the narwhal.
Really?
Yeah.
They're very protective animals. They really enjoy humans if they feel safe with them. They're very gentle. My cousin and I went to a llama farm where she lives in Connecticut, and we each had a llama to lead on a trail, and we learned about llamas, and they were just so sweet. And my cousin actually now works at that farm, at the llama farm. She gets to see llamas all the time. I'm so jealous because I don't have that in Michigan. So I guess it really started just with how gentle and beautiful and, you know, kind llamas are.
Yeah, all right, cool. Yeah, because my buddy had a llama obsession a few years ago on Facebook before it got flooded with hackers, marketers, and folks finally spewing some political stuff in their personal profiles. He would have these pictures of llamas and alpacas as his profile pictures for some strange reason. And I'm guessing their protectiveness is probably one of the reasons why.
Maybe. It is unusual that you had that. Maybe he needs to read The Love Llama.
Yep, he has a daughter now, so yeah, definitely.
Yes. Kids love the books. They love The Love Llama.
That's right. And plus, the alliteration is on fleek. That's right. Love llamas indeed. So my goodness, and of course, the narwhals indeed. So that was the first animal of choice. So is there a particular animal that's going to be next in the kingdom of love?
Yes. Every animal that Love meets on her journey in the first book around the world, they have a follow-up book. So Ned the Narwhal helps Love cross the Indian Ocean in the first book. And now he has his book where he's teaching children about the five oceans. And then after that, we're working on right now, Bob the Sloth explores South America. So, and Love met Bob in the Amazon rainforest in her book. And then we've got Ruby the Red Panda. She's going to be in Asia. Charlie the Cheetah is going to be in Africa. Peppermint the Penguin in Antarctica, teaching kids about environmental dangers and climate change and things like that. And who else do we have? Brave Feather the Owl in Europe. And Donut the Dingo Dog in Australia. See, do you like all the alliteration?
Donut the Dingo Dog. I freaking love it. All right. There we go. And of course, Peppermint Penguin. Like, yeah, we never got to have you back on the show. That's right. Talk about the Peppermint the Penguin.
Yes.
Of course, the Donut the Dingo. That's what I'm talking about.
But then there's Bob the Sloth. No alliteration there. It's just a sloth named Bob.
So does he bob for apples?
He's too lazy to bob for anything.
So is he going to bob his head to some great music in the book, at least.
There'll be some music, yep, when he gets to Brazil, for definitely.
Ah, there you go. That's what I'm talking about. Bob the Sloth, indeed. That's right. That's right. Bob might build something. Wait, no, he's lazy. Never mind, I forget. He won't be building anything then.
No, he's gonna be hitching rides with the other animals.
There you go. That's right. That's right indeed. He's gonna be hitchhiking. That's right. Bob the Sloth, the hitchhiker. That's right indeed. He's like, hey, I'm too lazy to drive. Mind if I catch a ride with you? Like, hey, don't throw that basketball over here. I just want to catch the ride, not a ball here. That's right. There's limits to this.
I don't think he can catch a basketball.
But hey, you're catching these questions very well. So is there a question that you wish to be asked more often when you're on the guest side of the game on these podcasts?
Oh, wow. That's a good question. I hadn't thought about that. Geez. I mean, you're asking all the right questions. I can't really think of anything. You caught me off guard.
Don't worry, you're on guard. That's right, you're on guard indeed. That's right indeed, because she's metaphorically fencing well, because you got these wonderful projects coming up with the different animals in the kingdom of fabulosity, of traveling the globe and spreading some positive messages to the kids, and heck, even to the grown-ups too. So is there anything else that you're going to be excited about in the near future?
Besides the books? The books are pretty much running the show right now. Well, I'm always excited about my kids, and they're doing really great back in school. They're so happy to be back in school. I have two in elementary, one in middle school, and one in high school. And they're, you know, like I said, they're just so excited to be back in school. I have some readings coming up, in-school readings. I'm excited about that. I just did a virtual reading today, actually, for a first grade class in California. And they're so cute. I mean, they're just like really good listeners and have great questions. And we also push social emotional learning, which I think is really important, especially during the pandemic, right? When kids weren't around other kids. So how do they even learn to be social, and how do they even learn, you know, the character strengths and things, positive messages, like you mentioned.
That's right, positive things indeed. I'm so glad that truck didn't make too much loud noise for too much longer, because my goodness, the bane of every podcast interview is freaking annoying. But anyways, excited about the kids. That's right, the kids. I know mommy's extra happy. She's like, yay, y'all can get out the house. I can put on my turtle shell now.
Yeah. I did those books during that time when they're at home. I was, you know, the teacher, the mom, and the author all rolled into one.
Ah, there you go. So how was that anyway for you? Because my goodness, like, it's bad enough because I'm still a single mom, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so.
It was a ride. It was a roller coaster ride. Oh my gosh. Just put on your seatbelt and hang on tight, because you didn't know when it was going to drop, when it was going to go upside down. You know, I mean, the great thing about it was my kids really bonded. They had to rely on each other. They became their own little support system. And we grew really close. I mean, I think that before that, I really hadn't had much quality time with them, because we were, you know, I worked. And then when I wasn't working, we were rushing around. You know, it was always rush, 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 rush to this extracurricular activity, rush to school, rush, you know, And so this put a stop to that, just a boom, a halt. And it was like, wow, you know, you have to re-examine your whole life. What are we going to do today with this free time? You know, what does that even look like? You're not used to having any relaxing downtime as a family. So we figured that out.
So there you go. That's right. From trapezoid into a square hole to a trapezoid in the trapezoid hole. That's right. That's right.
Something like that.
That's what I'm talking about indeed. That's what I'm talking about indeed. So in your lovely book of being the good everything on paper and being now a recovering alcoholic, and congrats on 3+ years. It's probably 4+ years now, if I'm not mistaken, alcohol free, right?
Not quite 4 years yet. No, that'll come up in February.
Okay, all right, the month of love, that's right. February for fall, that's what I'm talking about. That's right, she's gonna be playing golf in the snow in February for 4 years, that's right.
I actually got sober on my 40th birthday, so it's really easy to remember my sobriety date. It's the same as my birthday.
Oh, okay, someone's a February baby. All right, so when's your birthday so folks can send you some love letters?
February 11th, Aquarius.
Ah, all right, cool. Well, there you have it, folks. February 11th. Remember, Sharla Charpentier, Miss South Kakalaki, even though she's not in South Carolina at all. Send her some love notes, buy some books, ask some for some autographed copies, y'all. I'm telling you, that's right. Buy for your kids and your kids' kids. That's right. That's right indeed. That's right indeed. That's right indeed. So now that you're in the space of writing these children's books, is there another big goal that you seek to kind of reclaim since you may have, quote unquote, lost some of the creativity you may have had during those times of living for everybody else and now that you're living for yourself? Is there like another big thing that's like on your live it list instead of a bucket list?
Yeah, living list. I like it. Well, I created a board game based on the book series. And so I'm really excited about making that happen. It's going to take some time and, of course, some funding. But I was able to tap into my creative side to do that. It's really fun. And then also, we would love to have these characters featured in some kind of television series, some kind of animated. I mean, they're just such great characters, and kids just absolutely love them when they kind of meet these characters. They're just really fun, different characteristics and personalities. And, you know, for example, Ruby the Red Panda, she loves candy. She's always carrying around a candy jar, and she's got like sparkly nails. She's kind of a diva. She's gonna have like high heels on and fun stuff.
Oh no, because as you were saying that reminded me of episode 119 of the podcast with Jane Ransom. When I jokingly said, it's like, hey, let's have your book strut its knowledge by having some red shoes. And then out of nowhere, I'm not sure if she mentioned a panda or I did, but I'm like, yeah, find a panda with some red shoes. And if you Google panda with red shoes, it'll pop up a panda in some high heels. So voila.
Oh my gosh, that's so funny. Red panda with high heels. I guess we'll have to do red high heels.
That's right. Especially for the Chinese New Year, too, if it's the year of the panda.
If, yes. We need to coordinate that. Get that book for the year of the panda.
That's right. It doesn't need to know kung fu either. It just needs to have some red stilettos. That's right. That's right. Them Christian Lou Bottoms or Lou Bootins, whatever they are. Lou Bootins. whatever those extra dollar signs behind shoes are.
She just needs a manicure, mani-pedi all the time, you know. She doesn't even need those expensive shoes. She'll make her own. Maybe she can design her own shoe line.
That's right. I guess in her case, it'll be a mani handy.
Wouldn't it be a paw? Paw cure?
Well, there we go. I guess a mani paw pandy.
Mani paw pandy, yes. We'll write that down. Use that in the book.
You're writing down these one line that's coming out of my mouth, aren't you? He's like, I'm using these left for something later. Time of day job with a lawyer. It pays the bills, but darn it, and they some for abuse.
Oh, yeah. Gotta pay the bills somehow.
That's right. You're not Clinton, right?
Someday the books will pay the bills. Someday.
That's right indeed. That's right. Someday indeed. That's right. There you have it, folks. She heard it. She said someday. So let's make that today. Buy some copies of her magical books, The Mayhem to Miracles, as well as Ned the Narwhal, and of course, The Love Llama, and of course, Bob the Sloth. That's right, as he is slothing his way through South America. That's right. Going down to Brazil. That's right. Maybe chilling on not so Capitol Hill. That's right.
I'm gonna write that on the back. That's our marketing pitch. It's definitely the most fun interview I've had thus far.
That was good. Told you I'd keep it fun on the bun.
Yes, fun on the bun.
That's right. Especially when there's more than one bun. Put some honey on it, you know. Keep it sweet. That's right. Sweet and good enough to eat. Well, before I go any further down a bunch of rabbit holes of corn and nothingness, we're coming down to the magical question that every guest gets to receive, and that is, if you're to wake up tomorrow and you're 25 again, but this time in your current year, with all of your knowledge and experience, what advice would you give to yourself?
I would say do some self-care, do some self-reflection, stay true to yourself, tapping into your genuine, authentic self. Search out healthy coping skills. And if you don't know what those are, go see a therapist. No time like the present to start. 25 is just fine to start with. And try to get spirituality. I love it. I wish I had thought more about that in my 20s.
Well, hey, if it makes you feel any better, you're doing it now in your before pre-teen ages, since you're currently 4 years old. So, you know, that's right.
I'm well ahead of the curve.
Okay, if it's 41, it's supposed to be 14. I got you. Fine. Sheesh.
14 would have been nice, too. No, but just gratitude, being grateful every day. I mean, that's a game changer right there. Changing that perspective. You know, if there's a problem, there's always a silver lining. There's, I always say that there's good problems. You know, if it, a lot of people think, oh, I have this problem. But it actually is a good problem, because there's no wrong way to go about it. You know, it's just get through the problem, but on the other side, there's good stuff waiting for you.
That's right. Some good stuff indeed. That's right. It's good with all the O's out of 3 Cheerios boxes. It's good stuff. That's right. right, indeed. It's on the other side, y'all. That's right. So don't worry, it's not just chickens crossing the road, it's also humans crossing the road to get to the good stuff. Like the wonderful stuff that Sharla is offering, along with her wonderful soul sister. So for those who want to keep in contact with you and all the stuff that you're doing, and of course for future projects and books, what's the best way for folks to do so?
Website, www.thelovellamaandfriends.com, which is thelovellamaandfriends. So you got to remember there's two L's in love, just like there's two L's in llama. We're on Facebook at The Love Llama. We're on Twitter. We're on Instagram. We're on all that good stuff. And you can email us directly too, thelovellama@gmail.com. Two L's for llama, two L's for love.
So I'm talking about. That's right. Two L's for the love, two L's for the llama. That's right. She's on her LL Cool J swag, y'all. I'm telling you. That's right.
Yeah. Shout out to LL Cool J if you're listening.
In this case, it's LL Cool S. That's right. The Love Llama loves cool Sharla. That's right.
my new motto. I don't know.
That's right. That's right. Days, so there you have it, folks. Check out all the wonderful stuff that she just named. It's all going to be in a show notes. Check out her site. Check out her books. Check out her story in Mayhem to Miracles and that wonderful Sacred Stories of Transformation, indeed, where she's now alive, well, and kicking lots of arse, y'all. That's right. She's kicking butt out there, and she is going to be coming back on the show in the future for some more good times where she talks about the other friendly neighborhood creatures in the Love Kingdom with the Love Llamas and the Narwhals and the Sloth and, of course, the Red Panda with the Stilettos. That's right. Some Red Bottoms. That's right. And, of course, the Dingoes with all the donuts where he's going to be dunking them in some kangaroo pouches. It's going to be some good times. That's right. It's going to be some good times indeed. So, any parting words before we close up shop, Sharla?
Well, thank you so much for inviting me as a guest. It's been really fun. And I hope everyone learned something, maybe some words of wisdom I had for you. I don't know. I know life experience brings wisdom. And I'm just really happy to be with you tonight and really proud of our book series.
How's it going, my friend? I'm so glad you made it to the end. That shows that you are an uncommon finisher, and I am so grateful for you sharing your ears, your attention, and your time to this wonderful podcast to do something that'll take yourself to the next level. And for everybody else involved in this wonderful program, share it with at least three people in your network so that way more folks can not only catch the fire that is on this podcast, but can also be inspired to be their best. Advance others to advance yourself.